Hello, everyone. How are you? In general, on a Saturday morning, being here, heroes. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much for inviting me here today. Today, we'll talk to you about my work and how I investigate dementia on the preclinical point of view. So, how I try to understand what causes dementia in a system that is controlled and that is standardized and that is before the patient. So how I try to use animal models and mathematical models to understand what causes dementia. So my talk will be divided in three parts. First part will be dedicated to how the brain works through electricity, and I hope I will convince you that us, the scientists, don't use the combination between the brain and electricity to create the monster of Frankenstein. No monster of Frankenstein in our lab yet. The second part will be about memory and dementia, and here I brought two examples that to me represent the peak in the history of humanity, what memory is and what the dissolution of memory is. On the left you see the persistence of memory by Salvador Dalí, which is now maintained at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. So you've got solid shapes and a landscape and a figure that sleeps and melting clocks, which represent how time is not absolute, how time is fluid. And on one of these watches, there are the ends. There are these bugs that in Dalí's symbolic representation represented the progressive dissolution of memory. And at a distance of 20 years, Dalí represents the disintegration of the persistence of memory. And as you can see, the information is still there, but somehow the components of the information are broken down. And the more you go down to the horizon, the more information you lose. And finally, I will talk about how the mechanisms mediating memory and the loss of the same and electrophysiology can be combined to better understand dementia and Alzheimer's disease. So briefly about me, I come from the Republic of San Marino, where I grew up, and then I did my PhD in neuroscience at the University of Bologna, and then I moved to Bristol, where I worked with Professor Zafar Bashir, and then I got a job with Andy Randall studying the neuronal correlates of memory and learning, so trying to understand what happens in the single neural cells in mouse models overexpressing certain genes involved in the pathogenesis of Alzheimer's disease. I then moved to the University of Exeter, where I got my fellowship with the Alzheimer's Society, and recently I've been appointed lecturer at the University of Reading. And basically what I've been doing in the last 10 years was to stick electrodes into slices of brains to understand the electrical activity, how the electrical activity works when it underlies the encoding of new memory, and how the electrical activity in the brain of mouse models with Alzheimer's disease is altered, and if we can use this information to harness electrical properties that we can use for developing new therapies. So, first of all, some questions, right? Something that always fascinated me was how this mass of kind of disgusting flesh that is the brain can generate something so beautiful like poetry, like mathematics, like art, like our memories, the memories of our lifetime, and all the emotional content connected to that. The answer is that we don't really know how that happens, but we are on the way of understanding it, because even though the mind and the physiology have always been seen historically as two separate things. Neuroscience does the opposite. Neuroscience tries to understand what are the biological processes that underlie the functioning, the workings of the mind, including memory. Memory is something that is encoded by a specific set of operations at a neuronal level. And so also the loss of memory, the progressive cognitive decline, can be related to a specific biological mechanism that we can identify and possibly fix. So everything has to start with a functional unit. And traditionally, the functional unit of the brain is the neuron. The neuron is a very complicated machine, okay, itself. Without even considering the brain, the neuron itself is a very complicated machine. So I will not enter into the details of how a neuron works. Probably I don't even know how a neuron works completely. So I will stick to its surface, the plasma membrane, because as an electrophysiologist, as a person that studies the electrical activity of the brain, I mainly focus on this layer of fat that determines the surface of the brain, of the neuron. So it's not just a layer of fat that works as a border to define a border, but it also works as an electrical circuit. So I'm pretty sure most of you have seen the movie Matrix, right? And as a matter of fact, our neurons work like batteries, okay? And if you see the accumulation of positive and negative charges between the two sides of the plasma membrane of the neurons, you see that actually the electrostatic potential is higher than the electrostatic potential that there is between the clouds and the ground during a summer storm. So it contains a lot of energy. And this energy can be harnessed by an artificial intelligence to subdue the humanity, hopefully not, or it could be used by us to study the operations of the brain, okay? Because this electrostatic potential, as I will show you, is not static at all. It's something that fluctuates, and the fluctuations in this potential are used by the neuron as a way to process information and even to store information, see memory. So the first guy that had the idea was from another Italian from my same region, from Bologna, Luigi Galvani, which noticed that if you applied an electrical current to the legs of a frog, the legs would contract. So there was a coupling between electricity and a function, okay? It's gonna take 300 years to understand that between these experiments and the function of the neurons, we can identify specific mechanisms that underlie the functioning of the brain. And so in 1949, Hodgkin and Huxley in Plymouth, by working on the squid, just because in Plymouth at the Center for Marine Biology they had loads of them, good scientist knows how to optimize resources. And so there were loads of squids. Also, squids are pretty cool because they've got these big axons, these big neuronal processes that you can see under a microscope. And what they did was to characterize the electrical activity, the action potentials, these electrical spikes that you can see in the axons of the squid. So how this is relevant for Alzheimer's disease and memory and learning? Well, it is because in the brain, the neurons are connected to each other into networks. And so in a network, for the function to arise, there's always a balance between excitation of electrical activity and inhibition of electrical activity. And if everything works fine, it's like in an orchestra, where the inhibitor, the maestro, orchestrates the excitatory neurons. And if everything goes well, what you have is music, the workings of the mind. However, if you give too many coffees to the instrumentalists, or a couple of bottles of Chianti to the maestro before the execution, in other words, if you excite the excitation or you inhibit the inhibition, or both things at the same time, what you have is a mess. Okay, so this is the electrical activity from a slice of brain treated with a drug, ticotoxin, that inhibits the inhibition, and what you have is epileptic-like behavior. So that leads us to chapter two, where basically how we understood, right, the relationship between the different parts of the brain and memory and learning. And Wilder Penfield ran a series of experiments showing that by stimulating electrically different parts of the brain, you could evoke different memories. So he started to hypothesize that there were single neurons that encoded for different memories. So for example, if the patient was remembering the grandmother when a part of the brain was electrically stimulated, he hypothesized that there was a grandmother neuron. We do know that it's not like that nowadays, and we do know that thanks to the curious case of the patient HM. Patient HM had a rare case of bilateral drug-resistant epilepsy, so he had to undergo the removal of both hippocampi. And when he woke up from the surgery, he was perfectly fine. He remembered everything. However, he could not consolidate new memory for the long term. So the doctor had to introduce himself, or the nurses had to introduce themselves every time, every day. But the patient was getting better in, for example, doing crosswords or doing logic tests. So they understood that there were two kinds of memories, right? There was a memory of facts and events, and he lost the ability to consolidate that memory. And the memory that of procedures, right, of, playing an instrument or going on a bike, that was maintained. This is very important because it inspired some nice movies. But also because it gives us a lot to work in terms of studying dementia. So I will not discuss in detail what dementia is and how it is a great healthcare priority, both for the economical and the human cost that has worldwide, and for the reason that there is no cure, there is not a disease course changing or treatment, there's only a set of symptomatic treatments. This has been already discussed in detail. I would just like to talk briefly about Alzheimer's disease, which is the main cause of dementia. And I was talking with some of you during the break, and someone asked me, what the difference between familial and sporadic Alzheimer's disease. Familial is the genetic form, so what you inherit is a gene that almost certainly will give you the disease, and normally is early onset. The sporadic form is sporadic because we don't really know what causes it. So when scientists don't know what causes it, it becomes sporadic. So what we do know, though, is that there are genetic and environmental factors that increase the risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. But we still don't know clearly what is the causal connection between these risk factors and the disease itself. And also, we do know from post-mortem studies that there is that there are two specific hallmarks: the accumulation of beta amyloid plaques and intracellular tau tangles in the brain of people with Alzheimer's disease. So this becomes important because by putting together different sites, we also do know that epilepsy is increased in people with Alzheimer's disease. So there is an increased probability of epilepsy with age in people with Alzheimer's disease. So the question that I, as an electrophysiologist, ask myself is, can I study the electrical properties of neuronal cells in Alzheimer's disease? And can this help me to cure Alzheimer's disease? Is this epilepsy phenotype just a symptom, or something I can harness to actually cure the disease? So that leads us to chapter three, where we can we're going to talk about how to use electrophysiology for studying Alzheimer's disease. Lots of people ask me, but do you need animals? Do you need mice? Can't you use electroencephalography? We surely can. You can get a lot of information from electroencephalography. There's only a problem that the electrical activity is in the brain, and between the brain and your instrument, there is the skull. So the skull doesn't completely shield the electrical activity, but it's like looking at a person through a satin glass, right? You can still say something. You can say about the height. This person is probably reading a book and talking to a phone. It's probably a male from the way it dresses, but you can't be sure, right? So you already see that you're unsure about certain details. But if I ask you if that person has a mole on the left side of his or her upper lip, there's no way you can get that level of detail of information through the glass. There's only one way to get that information, which is to break the glass, and which is to break the skull, which you can't do on a patient, of course. And that's the reason why we use animals in dementia research. And basically what I do is to source genetically modified rodents that express dementia, express genes associated with human dementia. This is actually how they look in real life, not like in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And what their brain looks like is like this. So they show hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease, such as amyloid plaques or neurofibrillary tangles. So what I do in my lab is to humanely sacrifice these animals, remove the brain, cut slices, and keep the slices alive. The slices are perfused with a liquid that reproduces the liquid in which the brain is suspended in the skull. And then with a very small electrode, with a very small micropipette, I approach the single cell and I break the patch of membrane between the pipette and the cell. That allows me not only to be in contact with the inside of the cell, but also to measure the electrical activity of the whole cell. So, as we said, cells are like electrical circuits, and if someone here likes to play around with electrical circuits, we'll see that, as a matter of fact, the neuron is kind of a simplified circuit. There is a capacitance component, there is a resistive component, the channels, and there are other channels that can open and close depending on the electrical potential. And this is important because the properties of these cells can be represented mathematically and they can be simulated in computers. And with these experiments, I can push the cell to fire those electrical spikes which are necessary to encode information and memory, and I can measure quantitatively the waveform properties of this electrical activity, and I can see differences between mice that are normal, that are healthy, and mice that express genes associated with Alzheimer's disease. And I've been working on this for the last 6 years of my life. I've been working on different genetically modified mice, and what I consistently observed was this reduction in the width of the electrical spikes. And this is not trivial, because this means two things. That these animals can fire more of these spikes, because these spikes are narrower. And if they can fire more, it means that this could be a correlate of that epilepsy that we observe in patients. And this is also interesting, because what generates the narrowing of the width of the action potential is a specific protein of the plasma membrane, which is the voltage-gated potassium channel. Doesn't matter if you remember or not the name. What it matters is that it's a new target for a potential drug to rectify this alteration and possibly rectify the cognitive decline observed in people with Alzheimer's disease. Have I still got some time? So to sum up, epilepsy is more frequent in people with Alzheimer's disease. Epilepsy is caused by single neuron altered excitability. And we have consistently found changes in the action potential shape in neurons from Alzheimer genetically modified mice. So the answers to the questions I asked at the beginning, can we study the electrical properties of neuronal cells in Alzheimer's disease? Yes, with patch clamp, the only condition we need to do it in animals. Can this help me to cure Alzheimer's disease? Well, we certainly think so. If you want to know more details that I can't give for time reasons, I'm more than happy to answer to your questions later on. In the meanwhile, thank you very much for listening.